Good to see people again. It's very difficult to resist a hug, isn't it? But we're trying our best and succeeding. We thank God for that. We're continuing in our study of the book of Philemon. I want to begin by telling about this young man who was drunk and he was walking down the street, kind of off balance, but he also wore a necklace around his neck with a cross on it. And so an elder of the church that the young guy was a member of saw him drunk and he wasn't very happy with him. And so the elder was disappointed, walked up to him and said, "Aren't you a Christian? I mean, look at you, you're drunk. Why would you wear a cross around your neck with Jesus on it? You know, are you trying to make a mockery of Christians?" And the young man looked up at the elder and said, "This isn't Jesus' cross. This is the thief's cross." And I guess the moral of that story is that there are many Christians in the world who wear Christian symbols and do Christian things for different reasons. And there are other Christians who do things just to get their own way. Now let me ask you this question. When is a Christian not a Christian? In other words, would you recognize a false Christian? Remember what Jesus says, he says, "Watch out for those false prophets, they come to you in sheep clothing, but inwardly they are ferocious wolves. Fruit, you'll recognize them." You see, Jesus wanted to warn us that there are people out there who will wear the name Christian, but their lives don't reflect the attitude of Jesus. And he told us we need to be careful of them because inside they're really ferocious wolves. And so we need to be on guard against those type of people, but Jesus did say that you can recognize them by their fruit. You see, a real Christian will do things and is motivated with pure motivations for what they're doing. They do it with the fruit of the Spirit, with love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and faithfulness and gentleness and self-control. And so real Christians do things with pure motives, driven by the Holy Spirit. And so with that in mind, you can turn your Bibles to the book of Philemon. We're going to read from verse 47 today. Paul says, I always thank my God as I remember you my prayers, because I hear about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints. I pray that you will be active in sharing your faith, so that you will have a full understanding of every good thing we have in Christ. Your love has given me great joy and encouragement because you, brother, have refreshed the hearts of the saints. Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that a beautiful little paragraph? You see, the Christians at Philemon's house were genuine Christians, motivated by the fruit of the Spirit. And we know that they're genuine Christians because of the way their lives reflected their faith in Christ, Jesus. In other words, as somebody once said, our actions should speak louder than our words. And Paul's prayer life is abundantly clear, isn't it? I mean, he must be on his knees, praying constantly for thousands of people throughout the ancient world. Constantly praying. But then Philemon, a guy who was a genuine Christian, whose gifts abounded to the work of the Lord, did Philemon meet Paul's prayers? Oh, yes, he did. You see, loved ones, there's not a single Christian, no matter how devout they are, they don't need people to pray for them. We all need people to pray for us. Somebody once said, the best of all men know only in part, love only in part, and therefore, we need to pray for them, that their defects may be corrected and their lacks supplied. On earth, we are but wavering men who have not yet come to the end of the journey. Therefore, we need to be prayed for, that we may persevere to the end and finally receive the crown of life. And so we all need prayers, regardless of who we are. The Apostle Paul himself needed prayers. But today, Paul is going to give us three reasons why we should be thankful for our prayers for faithful, genuine Christians. And the first reason is this. We should be thankful for genuine Christians when they demonstrate their faith and their deeds together. You know, when it comes to faith, the world has got a very misleading misconception of the idea of what faith is. It's kind of like the guy who goes to the doctors and says, "Okay, doctor, give it to me straight, tell me in plain English, what's wrong with me?" The doctor says, "Okay, I'll be frank with you. My diagnosis is that you're just plain lazy." The guy says, "Okay, can you give me the scientific name so I can go home and tell my wife?" And that's what the devil was trying to do down through the centuries. Faith isn't very difficult. Faith is very easygoing. It doesn't require you to self-examine. It doesn't require you to do anything else. All you have to do is believe. And because of this misconception, many Christians in the world have become very lazy when it comes to their faith. In fact, the Bible says there's such a faith called death. Dead faith. James tells us, remember, it's in the same way faith by itself, if it's not accompanied by actions, is dead. A few verses later, he says, "As the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without deeds is dead." But the good news is this: that wasn't a problem for Philemon. That wasn't his problem. Because of his faith in the Lord, he was far from being lazy. He knew what real faith was all about. Paul said that, "I hear about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints." What a compliment that is, isn't it? Remember what Jesus says? He says, "A new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you're my disciples if you love one another." So what's new about this command? "As I have loved you, loved your enemies, turn your cheek, go the extra mile." This is completely strange, new love that Jesus wanted here. And that's exactly what Philemon had built his reputation on his faith in Christ and loving Christ. So both Onesimus and Epaphras have reported back to Paul that Philemon had continued to be faithful to the Lord, both towards the Lord and towards his brethren. You see, real faith is driven by love. And when you receive the love of the Lord, that love produces faith in action. It's why called faith with legs attached, if you wish. But let me ask you, what motivates your faith? Is it a fear of the future? Or a desire to be a better person in a better world? Is your faith motivated by the desire for a new changed life? Or is it more like a vaccination or an insurance policy against possible disaster? Remember when God tested Abraham in Genesis 22? God told him, he says, "Take your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on the mountain I will show you." You know, when you read these words, it's almost like God has got a dagger in his hand and is digging it deeper and deeper into Abraham's heart. "Take your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac." God is making this really personal. Now this journey that he had to take was a 3-day journey, about 56 miles, and so for Abraham to do what God wanted him to do, he was going to require faith with legs attached. You can imagine Abraham thinking to himself, "But God, this is my son, my only son, and you want me to sacrifice him? If that's what you want me to do, I'm going to do it." And we know he didn't, because James later tells us, doesn't he? He says, "You foolish person, do you want evidence that faith without deeds is useless? with the help of his son Isaac on the altar. You see, that his faith and his actions were working together. And his faith was made complete by what he did. And the scripture was fulfilled that says Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. And he was called God's friend. You see, a person is considered righteous by what they do, and not by faith alone. Do you see how Abraham's faith worked with his deeds? Remember in Exodus chapter 4, when God spoke to Moses and said to Moses, I want you to go back to Egypt and tell Pharaoh, let my people go. You remember the story? How over and over again, he gave excuse after excuse, and then he finally gave in to God and says, okay, God, if that's what you want me to do, that's what I'm going to do. And so Moses went there and journeyed about 370 odd miles back to Egypt from Midian. The point is this: God told Abraham what to do, where to go, and how to do it. And he told Moses what to do, where to go, and where to do it. But they were both willing to do what God said. They were willing to do what God told them to do. Now, I say all of this because Philemon is no exception in all of this. His faith in Jesus led him to do good deeds, and his good deeds were shown in his love for all the saints. You see, even though Paul is in prison in Rome under house arrest, what's all but back to Paul about Philemon? About his faith and his good deeds. And he told Philemon that he's heard about his faith with legs attached. He's heard about his faith in the Lord, and he's heard about all his love that he has for all the saints. And this is an incredible testimony, isn't it? What do people hear about you as a Christian? See, most time you hear about Christians, all the time is very negative, isn't it? It's very negative. Or we're having some serious problems over here because somebody wants us to use the Coda's boot. Or we're having a bit of a division over this congregation because somebody wants to use the King James Version only. You know, wouldn't it be nice to hear that Christians are doing great because they're serving their God? They're serving their God, and they're serving their God out of love. You see, that's what's happening with Philemon. Paul's saying, listen, I hear what you're doing for other saints. And he says, I know you're doing it because you're motivated by the love that God's got for you. And when you practice a love like that, people are going to talk about it. John says, dear children, that's not love with words or tongue, but with actions and in truth. In other words, like we did with the youth weekend last year, don't tell me you're a Christian. Show me you're a Christian. Our faith and our needs and our deeds need to work together. Or as Paul tells us, the only thing that counts is faith expressing itself through love. I love that story about the guy who went to heaven and he spoke to the Lord. And the Lord said to him, come on, I'm going to show you hell. And so they entered this room. There was a group of people all surrounding this great big pot of stew. Everybody's famished. Everybody's desperate. Everybody's starving. And each held a spoon that reached the pot. But each spoon had a handle so much longer than their own length of their arms, that couldn't be used to get the stew in their mouths. I mean, the suffering was absolutely terrible. And then the Lord says, come, I'll show you heaven. And so they enter this other room, identical to the first, pot of stew, group of people, long-handed spoons. But here, everybody's really happy. And everybody's well nourished. And the guy says, well, I don't understand why are they happy here, and yet Again, the Lord said, that's simple. It's simple. Here, they've learned to feed each other. Listen, little ones, you're a walking, talking advertisement for God, and your faith and your deeds need to work together. James says, what good is it, my brother and sisters, if somebody claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such a faith save them? Suppose a brother or a sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to them, go with peace, keep warm and well fed, but there's nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if not accompanied by actions, is dead. You see, if your brother or sister needs help and you just ignore them, what James is telling us is more than what's written on the screen here. It goes beyond this. If you see a brother or sister in need and you just ignore them, you know what you're doing? You're telling them that you and God just don't care for them. You're telling the world you actually don't care for them. If a non-Christian person needs help, and you come along and you can't help because you're too busy or whatever, you're telling them and you're telling the world that God simply doesn't care for them. You see, it has a bigger impact than what's on the screen. The Christian faith needs to be a genuine faith with legs attached. A faith that shows through love. A faith that leads to serve others. The second point is this: the more you share your faith, the more you learn about Christ. There's this guy who wanted to sell his house. And so he called his friend who was an estate agent and called him over to the house. And he said, listen, I want you to write down and put an advertisement in the paper to sell my house. So the guy started to write it down and describing it as he was going along to put it in the local newspaper. And when he had finished writing it, his friend said to him, can you read that again, how you just described my house? And so he read it again. And he said, please, can you read it one more time? So he read it again. And he said, the house is not for sale. All my life, I wanted a place just like the one you described. But I never knew I had it until I heard you, what you had written about it. Now that's what Paul means when he says, I pray that you be active in sharing your faith so that you will have a full understanding of every good thing we have in Christ. Paul says the deeper Philemon recognizes how greatly he's blessed himself, the more motivated he's going to be to extend mercy and pardon to others, especially Onesimus. And the very fact that Philemon has displayed this loving spirit in the past convinces Paul that he's not writing in vain. Now remember, Paul hasn't mentioned Onesimus yet. He hasn't mentioned him up to this point. What he's doing is laying the foundation of his letter. And so Paul is clearing the ground and cultivating the soil of Philemon's heart before planting the name of Onesimus in verse 10. And Paul wrote this letter with the problem of Onesimus. And so he was complimenting Philemon concerning his reputation and the sharing of his faith. He's reminding Philemon of his good Christian behavior because he's eventually going to have to address the delicate issue of Onesimus who ran away to Rome. He's going to get there. In other words, what Paul is doing here is he wants Philemon to see how much forgiveness he needed so that he can extend that forgiveness towards Onesimus. He's saying, listen, the more you actively share your faith with others, the more you realize exactly what it is you've got in Christ. Or as Peter would say, we will have an answer for the hope that we have. And please note, this verse doesn't teach that we look to have the answer for everything. Doesn't say that. It's for the hope that we have. In other words, when we realize what we have in Christ Jesus as Christians, we're going to be so excited about it. We want to share it with others. And the more we share with others, the more truths we learn from God's Word, the more we learn from God's Word, the more we want to share that with even more people. It's kind of like saying, guess what I found? I found a man who used to be a carpenter in a place called Nazareth. I found a man who totally changed my life. And the reason he changed my life is because he died for me. He gave his life for me. And it's your lucky day. It's your lucky day. Because I'm here to share with you some of the things I've learned and how my life has changed since I knew this man called Jesus Christ. You see, that's exactly what Philemon has been doing. He's been actively sharing his faith with others. He's heard what Jesus taught. You are a light of the world. Let your light shine before men that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. You see, Philemon is beginning to understand more and more fully all the good things he has because he's a Christian. And so because of that understanding, he wants to share his faith with others. He wants to let his light shine. And there's no better way than letting your light shine than doing good deeds for others in the name of Jesus. And that brings us to the final point. When your good deeds and faith work together, it's going to have an effect on other people. Now let me ask you, what brings you joy? Does it bring you joy when you see Christians fighting? Does it bring you joy when you see Christians not using their talents? Or does it bring you joy when you see Christians actively sharing their faith with others because they're motivated by the love of God? You see, it gives me joy when I hear and see other Christians actively sharing their faith with others. I mean, it encourages me so much that refreshes my heart. And that's what Paul said about Philemon. He says, your love has given me great joy and encouragement because you, brother, have refreshed the hearts of the saints. You see, Paul's only hope for an essence and its foundation in the kind of man that Paul knew that Philemon was. And what kind of man was Philemon? He's Paul's brother. Paul's brother in Christ. And loved ones, there is no greater compliment to be called somebody's brother or somebody's sister in Christ. Philemon was not a nominal Christian. Paul's commendation of his Christian behavior reveals that this brother had a great reputation on all those he had come in contact with everybody. He was a disciple who made an impact in the lives of people, even people outside of the lives of Colossae where he lived. I mean, you think about it, you know, God must be so delighted when Christians show proper concern for everyone else and refreshes the hearts of the saints. God must be encouraged by that. See, Philemon's love is so evident. He was well respected in his community, but his love for everybody is so evident, it went beyond his community. We took the earlier news of this reached Rome, where Paul was, about 1,200 miles away. And Paul has heard what Philemon is doing. Isn't that incredible? And so Paul says, it brings him a lot of joy. And it gives him a lot of encouragement. And Paul is more or less saying, listen, Philemon, every time I get a Christian visit to come visit me when I'm in the house arrest, guess who I'm talking about? I'm talking about you and your faith and your love for others. And I'm not a Roman dictatorship. That's got to be great news for other Christians. That's and refresh our hearts. Have you ever had times in your life where it seems like nothing but bad news? You know, my brother calls me every now and again. And every time he calls me, he keeps saying to me, "Sorry, bro, I've got bad news for you." There's always something happening. That's the only time we really speak, when there's bad news. But you see, when you get bad news, it makes us feel sad. And sometimes it really discourages us. But when we hear of a Christian, or a church as a whole, who are loving their fellow brothers and sisters in the Lord, doesn't that make your heart fill with joy? And not only that, when we realise that they're actively sharing their faith with non-Christians, I mean, doesn't that give you encouragement? And that joy, that encouragement, helps us carry on helping others. And when we hear of churches or individuals who are actively doing that, then that should encourage us all just to be like them, to do what they do. You see, when encouragement flows like that, you want to carry on feeding those who are being fed spiritually. You want to carry on doing good deeds. You don't want to give up when you hear about active members of the Lord's body. You don't want to give up when you hear good news. Or as Paul would say, let us not become weary by doing good, for at the proper time you will reap a harvest if you do not give up. And that's why Paul says to Philemon right at the very beginning, I always thank my God as I remember you in my prayers. You see, the Apostle Paul was prayer disciplined. He always prayed with an appreciation for faithful Christians. He always mentions individuals by names or congregations by name in his prayers. And here he gives his thanks for Philemon. Have you ever seen those pictures or those models of the praying hands? I'm sure you've seen them in the shops, got the praying hands and things. Let me tell you the story behind those. It's quite an interesting little story. There were two men, and both of them were artists, but they never had enough money to go through college. And so they decided to flip a coin. The winner would go to college, the loser would go get a job to help that person through college. And one day, the college man came home, and he saw his friend praying. His hands were no longer the hands of an artist. They were covered in blisters. They were covered in bumps and lumps. He would never again be able to draw like he once did. And so this touched the artist that his friend would give up his talent to allow him to go through school. And so he sat down and he drew his hands. The point is this. We too should be praying to God with thankfulness in our hearts for those Christians who give up their time to serve the Lord. I'm not just talking about full-time preachers here. I'm talking about faithful Christians who actively serve God, whether it's through helping others, whether it's helping the poor or sharing the gospel with somebody. We should be remembering these people and thanking God for them. You see, Paul wasn't just thankful for Philemon. He was thankful because of his faith in God. He was thankful because of his love for all the saints. He was thankful for his activeness in sharing his faith. He was thankful because he realized what he had in Christ. He was thankful because of the joy and encouragement he gave Paul. And he was thankful because he refreshed the hearts of the saints. Now, I don't know about you, but that ought to make us thankful. We should be really thankful. We ought to be thankful for Jesus and for the forgiveness of our sins. We ought to be thankful for being alive today and having our very lives. And we should be thankful for every grain that comes from the ground and enters our mouth. We should know how to pray with thankfulness. It's like a little six-year-old boy who was invited to go to his friend's house for a meal. And he sat down, The food was served at the table and everybody just got stuck into the food. The little boy was a bit puzzled. They said to his friend's father, he says, don't you guys pray before you eat? And his friend's father said, well, we do that here, son. The little boy says, wow, you guys are just like my dog. He's just big straight in. Colossians 4:17 says, whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God, the Father through Him. Now it's sad that many Christians actually think they're thanking God for the food they're about to eat, but they're not. Let me explain that. How many times have you heard somebody say, Father in heaven, please bless this food we're about to eat? How many times have you heard that? I mean, is that food that bad that you want God to miraculously make it good before you eat it? When Jesus was about to feed the 5,000, He didn't bless the food. Notice what He said. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish and looking up to heaven, He gave thanks and broke it. You see, Jesus didn't bless the food. He gave thanks to God for providing that food in the first place. How many times have you had somebody put the Lord's table? Father, bless this bread, bless this wine. I mean, is there something wrong with the bread and wine? Does it need to be sacrificed before we partake of it? Jesus says, while they were eating, Jesus took bread and when He had given thanks, He broke it. Gave it to His disciples saying, this is my body. And then He took a cup and when He had given thanks, He gave it to them and they all drank of it. You see, Jesus didn't bless the bread and the wine. He gave thanks to God for supplying that bread and wine. Now as Christians, we should have many reasons to be thankful. And we need to take every opportunity we can to get down on our knees and tell God just how thankful we are. And if you're not a Christian this morning, then you too can have many reasons to be thankful. Come to Jesus. Receive His love and His forgiveness. And in doing so, not only will you refresh the hearts of the saints here, but you refresh the hearts of the saints all over the world. In fact, Jesus said that, didn't He? He said that when a person comes to Him in repentance, it refreshes the hearts of those in heaven. You see how there's a bigger impact? In the parable of the lost coin, Jesus says, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. Now we usually use this verse as if for somebody who's just become a Christian, but let me tell you, loved ones, every time someone repents of their sins, Christian or not, the hearts of the angels have been refreshed in heaven. So let's all be thankful. Let's all serve God and each other in love. Let's build up a good reputation for ourselves and as a church, which is driven and built on the foundation of God's love for us. God bless you.